greet all of you again this morning in the name of the Lord Jesus. What a blessed thing it is to sing His truth, to sing things that are in harmony with the Word of God. I don't know how many of us really believe that we want a life of self-renouncing love. And that is what we just sang. Self-renouncing rather than self-exalting. We're pretty good at the second one. Not so easy to do the first one. Self-renouncing love. But that is the life of our Lord Jesus. That's what we see in Him in every page of Scripture. A glorious self-renouncing love. We are deeply grateful that the Lord has brought you this way today, whether you are members or regular attendees or whether you are visiting with us today. We do pray that God's mighty Spirit would be in this place, that we would know His presence, that we would love Him with all of our hearts and love others. We do not wish to come here without thinking of the admonition that Solomon gave us last week. Keep thy foot when thou goest to the house of God, and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools. Be not rash with thy mouth. Why? For God is in heaven, and thou art on earth. And may we come this morning humbly ready to hear from our God and to be transformed and to be made more like Christ. If you have a cell phone, would you please check it right now and make sure that it's on mute? And if you have little ones, or if you're a nursing mother, we have wonderful accommodations precisely for that. In fact, I don't know if we're going to end up with a waiting line for the nursing mother's room. We've got so many new babies, and those that are still nursing, we may have to add another room, for which we praise the Lord. We've had a marvelous harvest of children so far the last 2 years. Wonderful that God has so graciously blessed us with these precious children. If your little ones are having one of those days, you can take them right back into that room, right through that large gray door, and you can quiet them in there without fear of concern or troubling anyone else. That's exactly what we set it aside for. And we have a large screen so that you can continue following the message. And we also have a screen in the nursing mother's room. So please make use of those. You will not disturb us by getting up and taking one out. You will see our people do it with some regularity. We are delighted that we have so many precious children here with us as we lift our voices in praise to God with the songs of Zion, as we hear the prayers of those leading us to the throne of grace, and as we hear the inspired and infallible Word of God. If you would open your Bibles with me this morning to Matthew chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23. We begin a new chapter today. We're going to read the first 12 verses. Matthew chapter 23, let's stand together and give our attention to the blessed Word of God. Matthew 23, beginning in verse 1, let us hear the Word of God. Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to His disciples, saying, "The scribes and Pharisees the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments, and love the uppermost seats at feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues, and greetings in the marketplace, and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi. But be ye not, or but be not ye called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your Father which is in heaven. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased. And he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. Amen. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. Brethren, as we stand in the presence of God, let us lift our hearts together with one mind before our God. Plead for his blessing upon the service today. O holy and righteous Father, what a great mercy it is that Thou hast called us to this place today. The four walls of this building are merely for us to have a location and one of some comforts as we hear Thy word. But Thy church is Thy people, the gathered, Spirit-filled people of God. And Lord, I pray that every regenerate heart has come prepared this day to worship Thee in spirit and in truth. This is our heart's desire. Lord, we are undertaking three very weighty and difficult chapters as we continue in Matthew. And I pray with all of my heart that Thou wouldst help me to preach this to Thy people in a way that would bring Thee glory. Lord, no doubt there will be reproofs, rebuke, exhortation as we read Thy stringent, Thy fierce words. But we do pray that as we hear Thy words, that our eyes would be fixed on Thee. Let us examine ourselves and see our own Phariseeism. Lord, may we not be looking around in our mind or in our physical bodies during these messages, but may we, with the mirror of Thy word, look at ourselves. Help us and reprove and rebuke and exhort us, but strengthen and comfort and fill our hearts with joy. Lord, if we find that wicked Pharisaism in us, grant us the grace to identify it and mortify it. By the power of the cross of Jesus Christ, by His precious shed blood, and by the power of Thy Spirit, informed by Thy word. Come, Almighty God. Come today. Come and move in our midst. We do not need just our religious time cards punched today. Shake us out of our worldliness. Shake us out of the things that would distract us. Oh, and give us a fresh and clear mind to hear thy word today, to hear thy voice by thy Spirit in thy precious word. Father, I pray that we have come prepared, having been urged to that last Lord's Day and Wednesday. Help us to hear. Help us to be more ready to hear. And help us in how we hear. Help us to hear, O Christ, prayerfully, Christocentrically, believingly. Help us to hear, O God, reverently. I pray that we would hear it awakeningly. Oh, may the lost today hear thy truth and believe thy words unto everlasting life. May they believe on the living Christ. Now, Father, thou knowest us, and I pray that by thy mighty power, thou wouldst deal with us, beginning behind this pulpit, and that all of us would know that we are not only in the presence of our God, but that our God is speaking. Let us hear and be transformed. Help us to be more like our Savior, and help us to bring thee glory in the obedience that follows. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Since chapter 16 of Matthew's Gospel, Jesus has been on his way to the cross of Calvary. Leaving Caesarea Philippi, he finally arrived in Jerusalem at Passover, when thousands of pilgrims were gathered for that God-appointed festival. Now, as we have seen, chapters 21 and 22 describe a series of escalating controversies between Jesus and the Jewish religious elite in the temple. Chapter 21 reveals that after his prophetic and kingly entry into the holy city, Jesus went into the temple. He answered the chief priests and the scribes when they protested. Children praising his miracles in the temple. Then he silenced the chief priests and the elders when they questioned his display of authority in the temple. And then Jesus spoke two of three parables against those leaders. Chapter 22, Jesus directed his third parable at the religious authorities, and then three verbal confrontations with them arose. The first was the Pharisees' disciples along with some Herodians. Second was certain Sadducees. And thirdly, a Pharisaic lawyer. All tried their hand at trapping Jesus and discrediting his teaching with three clever political and theological questions. But Jesus answered all three with startling wisdom and then turned the tables, asking the Pharisees four questions. What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he? And when they answered correctly, the son of David, Jesus asked, how then doth David in spirit call him Lord? If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? Of course, the answer to these profound questions was standing in the temple in the very presence of the scribes and Pharisees. Jesus, the Son of the living God, who became David's descendant by a Spirit-wrought miracle in the Virgin Mary's womb. Jesus' question, what think ye of Christ? What think ye of Christ? Is crucial. It stands at the very heart of the gospel of God's grace. How you answer that question is all the indication of where you will spend eternity. What think ye of Christ? Despite Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem to the shouts of Hosanna to the Son of David, his purging the temple, his miracles, his authoritative teaching, and his profound answers to their questions, the Jewish leaders did not believe that Jesus was David's son and David's Lord. They did not believe that he was and is the Christ. They tried to trap Jesus, and he trapped them. Now, this is the context of chapter 23. This sobering and weighty chapter consists of three parts. One, Jesus will warn the multitude and his disciples about the pride and hypocrisy of the Jewish leaders. Two, he will pronounce 8 scathing woes against them. And three, he will lament Jerusalem's unbelief and looming destruction. The city of God will be devastated. And this chapter gives us keen insight as to why. As we will see, this chapter is crucial to Matthew's life of Christ. It serves as a transition that concludes Jesus' controversies with the religious elite in chapters 21 and 22. And it introduces chapters 24 and 25, which present Jesus' 5th and final major block of teaching in Matthew's gospel. As the climax of Jesus' controversies with the religious leaders, this chapter prepares our hearts for Jesus' dreadful destruction of Jerusalem and his breathtaking description of the day of judgment. We want to give careful heed to these chapters. So our message is entitled Hypocrisy and Dead Religion, Part 1. And may our loving Heavenly Father grant us eyes to see and ears to hear our Savior. Is that what you came to do today? To hear your Savior's voice in His Word. That's what we want. Oh God, grant it. May our Father give us eyes to see and ears to hear our Savior through the Holy Spirit's illuminating, awakening, and regenerating power. Well, first, Jesus turned his focus from the leaders to the people listening. Verse 1. Thus far, Jesus has spoken parables to, answered questions from, and asked questions of the Jewish religious hierarchy. Yet now the sacred text says, "Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples." Luke puts it this way, "Then in the audience of all the people, he said unto his disciples." Jesus had been directly addressing the scribes and Pharisees. But now he makes a vital change of focus. The chapter break is not helpful here, because the opening word, "then," is significant, which makes it easy for us to miss the crucial link with chapter 22, verses 41 through 46. We just do it. We make a mental break. New chapter, and the thoughts fly out the window. It would have been better if they just had a double-length chapter here, because all this is directly connected, especially to what Christ says in chapter 41, verses in chapter 22, verses 41 through 46. "What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he?" After confounding his opponents with the question, "How could David's son be David's Lord?" no man was able to answer him a word. Neither durst any man from that day forth ask him any more questions. Jesus shut the mouths of his enemies. Then, Jesus shut the mouths of his enemies. Then, he turned his attention to the huge crowds, and especially the disciples. They had been listening to the disputes between Jesus and the religious elite in the temple court. Remember, Jesus had entered the holy city to the praise of the people, cleansed the house of prayer from its money changers and sacrifice sellers, worked miracles to the praise of children, and taught the people with astonishing authority. Furthermore, he publicly defeated, humiliated, and shut the mouths of the Jewish leaders in the very house of God, in the presence of all the people. Then, in their presence, Jesus graphically exposed the scribes and Pharisees' pride and hypocrisy. He didn't put his arm around them, take them off into the corner of one of the temple, near one of the temple walls, and say, "You know, you guys don't quite have it right." Now let us remember who Jesus was dealing with. The scribes were well-educated theologians and professional teachers of God's law. After intense, rigorous study, they generally became judges, teachers, and influential decision makers in matters of religion, law, and morality. In other words, they were movers and shakers among the Jews. And the Pharisees, whose name means separated ones, came from a wide variety of social backgrounds. Sometimes they were workmen, they were merchants. But the Jewish historian Josephus tells us that in the first century, out of about 1 million Jews in Israel, only 6,000 of them were Pharisees. But their reputation for holiness and good works gave them profound influence among the common people. For a small group, they had broad, wide-ranging influence in the minds of the people of Israel. Although scribes and Pharisees were two distinct groups, most of the scribes were Pharisees. And most, or at least many, of the Pharisees, some of the Pharisees anyway, were scribes. The Jews highly respected the Pharisees for their religious zeal. Now, isn't that just like us? We kind of like the fired up people. We watch them. We say, oh, that I were more like that. Now, properly understood, that's not necessarily a bad thing. The problem is, are the things they are doing arising out of love for God, for His people, and from the Word of God? We can all get four or five things that we think we don't have much of a problem with, make a list and make it look before everybody like we're doing pretty well. And that is precisely what Jesus despises and curses here. They were respected for their zeal. They were respected for their good works, for their tithing, for their fasting, and for their prayers. There were Pharisees, by the way, who were not hostile toward Jesus, such as Nicodemus, who appears to have become a follower of Christ. And the Pharisees who warned Jesus, "Get thee out and depart hence, for Herod will kill thee." Luke 13:31. Nevertheless, the majority rejected John the Baptist's ministry, rejected Jesus and his claims, and plotted our Lord's destruction. The Jewish writing known as Perek Avot, chapter 1, verse 1, from the Mishnah, gives some insight into the way the scribes and Pharisees thought. Quote, "Moses received Torah," means the law, "Moses received Torah at Sinai and handed it on to Joshua, Joshua to elders, and elders to prophets, and prophets handed it on to the men of the great assembly. They said three things. One, be prudent in judgment. Two, raise up many disciples. Three, make a fence for the Torah." Close quote. Now, their idea of making a fence around God's law produced numerous rules and regulations added to the law that were meant to keep the Jews from breaking it. Here's the line for breaking the law. We're going to put some fences out about here. That way you can't get to breaking the law if you keep the stuff we tell you. And these fences lay at the heart of the heavy burdens that the scribes and Pharisees laid upon their fellow Jews. Jesus is going to rebuke that. Now, brethren, before we go any further, every regenerate soul in this room knows, or at least should know, Phariseeism is the religion of the flesh. You've got it, you're infected with it, and you make as many rules as you can that very often have nothing to do with what God says. And those things become your acid test for whether somebody's really a believer or not. We don't have a TV in our house. They do. I don't have anything good to say about television. It wouldn't bother me if everybody went home and took an axe to theirs. But the fact of the matter is, that's not ultimately the acid test. We saw an example of offense in chapter 12 when Jesus and his disciples walked through the grain field on the Sabbath. The disciples were hungry, and they plucked some ears of grain to eat. Now, this involved rubbing their hands together to separate the grain from the chaff. Now, the Pharisees categorized this as work and then condemned them as Sabbath breakers. That's the way it works. Now, with this in mind, Jesus declared the leaders legitimate authority. Verses 2 and 3a. He said, "The scribes and Pharisees sit in Moses' seat." Now, what is Moses' seat? Well, among the many controversies that accompany this text, this one has been much disputed. While at least four meanings have been suggested, the most reasonable explanation is the classic interpretation. When Israel's teachers taught in the synagogues, they were usually seated while teaching the people. Actually, backwards from the way we do it today. The teacher sat, the people stood. That doesn't sound too bad. Do we have a motion to change this? Well, the notion then was that the teachers sat and they would teach the people as they stood. Some archaeological evidence indicates that there were stone seats upon which learned men sat and taught the people. However, this evidence is after the Christian era, and it is not presently known if they were in use in Christ's day, though some surmise that that's the case. There's no sure evidence. But whether there was an actual seat or chair, Moses was the supreme lawgiver. This is what the text is getting at. This is what the heart of the text is going for. Moses was the supreme lawgiver, and his God-given authority was symbolized by those who interpreted and taught the law of Moses to God's people. We get that? So to sit in his seat, so to speak, was to be God's authoritative mouthpiece. Therefore, we can understand why Jesus said, "All therefore, whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do." Now, that's quite a remarkable statement. And I wrestled with whether to stop there, drop anchor, and spend a few moments. I won't do that because we've got lots to consider, even in these first 12 verses. Only a little over half of which we will consider today, God willing. But the fact is, Jesus is saying, as a footnote to this, that the character of the teacher does not mean that you throw out the teaching if they happen not to be of great character. That, of course, means we've got to know what the Scriptures teach. And we've got to examine what we hear from pulpits, over the radio, over the internet, all these kinds of things. But the fact of the matter is, far too often, and Satan is wildly successful at this, if a well-known preacher falls, a huge number of people will throw out everything that he's taught. That is unwise. Christ's very endorsement of these dark-hearted teachers makes the point. He says, when they tell you to do what God has said through Moses, you do that because God said it through Moses. Well, we must press on. Now, one thing we have to understand here is that our Lord was not telling his hearers to submit to every fence the scribes and Pharisees demanded. That is not what he's saying. Though a number of commentators take a different perspective, I can hardly accept the other views. Jesus' reference to Moses' seat sets the context. The traditions of the elders did not come from Moses. Jesus said, listen when they're teaching Moses. Not everything that they came up with. Jesus had rebuked the Jewish leaders, as a matter of fact, because of their man-made traditions. When they asked him why his disciples did not keep the tradition of the elders, Jesus replied, why do ye also transgress the commandment of God by your tradition? Ye have made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. Now, brethren, listen carefully, please. It's still early. I hope you're not drifting yet. But if you're drifting, come back to the dock. See if the Lord won't tie you up to it. Stay right there and hear. Man-made fences, laws, slogans, and traditions usually, not always, but usually replace and obscure the Word of God in the minds of the people of God. Let me say again, man-made fences, laws, slogans, and traditions. Usually, there are biblical traditions in the Scripture. Paul the Apostle says so. But these fences, laws, and slogans usually replace and obscure the Word of God in the minds of God's people. I was witnessing to a man downtown just this last week. And I said a couple of things to him, and he said, Yeah, well, I've just learned to let go and let God. That's one of the reasons he's homeless. That is a slogan. That slogan is not biblical. And it has been among God's people for decades now. Came out of the Keswick movement, the higher life movement. Brethren, I will tell you, it sounds good. It sounds spiritual, but it's not the Word of God. It's not the key to holiness. And people take these kind of things and they say them just like God had spoken them and recorded them in His Word. Let go and let God. I'm not saying there's never a context in which that combination of words might not be applicable. I'm talking about the theological slogan that has filled America, that comes from what I believe to be an aberrant view of the Christian life made popular by many well-known men. It's still around us. Brethren, slogan Christianity is destructive to Christianity. You must know the Word of God. what God said. And then once you get what God said, then you need to understand what God meant. Because we hear words differently. We have to understand what He said, get that right, and then what He meant by what He said, and then apply it to our lives. Slogans very often take us down a path that later on we will regret. Make sure you're operating according to a proper contextual understanding of what the Word is saying. Israel's teachers were only authoritative as they taught God's truth to God's people. The fences that they put around God's law were not from Moses. So Jesus meant something like this. When the scribes and Pharisees speak the authoritative law of Moses to you, guard it and do it. Oh, how vital it is. Brethren, how vital it is for preachers of God's Word to handle it faithfully without adding fences. Our good ideas are always cluttering up the landscape of scriptural truth, and the effect always hits the church, God's people. Well, then Jesus warned His hearers not to imitate the leaders' hypocrisy. Verse 3, the second part, B. Jesus did not come to destroy the law, and He had commanded the Jews to walk in it, even though their teachers were faulty. But then He warned, "Do not ye after their works, for they say, and do not." Brethren, that's sobering. With what the Lord's about to do, we need to sit up and take very careful evaluation of ourselves. Jesus says, don't do what they do. Well, what is that? They say and do not. Fathers, I want every father to hear this. Do you know you destroy your home when you say and you do not, according to the Word of God? Do you know that? You will answer to Almighty God. Are you telling your children that you're a miserable hypocrite by your life? Are you telling your children, well, it's important to do what I say, but not as I do? You can fan the flames of the sparks of hypocrisy your children are born with. Moms, professing Christians everywhere, do you say to the world, I belong in the category that Jesus is talking about here? I say, I talk about Jesus. I can work up a good lather with people about Jesus and what I'm reading and about sovereign grace and about election and about particular redemption. And I can tell you all about this stuff. My life is a wreck. Look at my marriage. Look at my children. Look at the way I live. What would Christ say to us? Do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. That ought to make every elder on the planet shudder and cast himself on the Lord Jesus for grace and mercy. And every professing Christian as well. As we will see in this chapter, the scribes and the Pharisees majored on minors. We got anybody here does that? No, we can take someone else, right? They majored on minors. Jesus said, don't do that. But they omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. It is remarkable in the embarrassingly long history of church splits what people split over. There's a good reason to get up and walk out of a church if the pastor doesn't preach the God-man. But we've always got that little list that if they don't go with these five things, man, I'm gone. Or these two, or this one, or these ten. Now, don't misunderstand me. There are times to separate. There are times when the doctrine involved and the what it produces in the life of someone is evidently not God's truth and not the Spirit of God. And especially if that's in the leadership, there may be a time to say, this is not a good place for my children. This is not a good place for my wife. This is not a good place for us. And you have a responsibility to go. But far too often, brethren, we get down on something that's secondary, even important, but we say, I have nothing to do with these people. They majored on minors. They found things that they were so persnickety about that everybody had to fall right in with that, but they themselves are ignoring the weighty things of the law. Jesus himself said it. Judgment. We'll talk about this more in the weeks ahead. Mercy. Faith. We understand how important that is. It's tragic that even we who are recipients of the grace of God under the New Testament, which was established upon better promises, often do the same. It is of the nature of the flesh to talk about God without obeying God. I never thought I'd get to this place in my ministry. I've always have a desire to help someone in need, to encourage them, to help them along the way, to say, all right, there's a better way. Here's what the Word of God says. Here's how you can approach these things. Pray in this direction. Start adding some of these things from the Word of God into your daily thinking and exit out some of those others. I never thought I'd come to the place where I'd say, that's it. I'm sorry. I can't help you until you give some kind of indication that you're willing to walk in what the Word of God says. But it happens. You can spend weeks with people. You can bleed for them. And they'll go listen to somebody else. Or they'll hear all that stuff you're doing and just go, all you're saying, and go right on with what they're doing. This is dead religion, not life in Christ. Nobody's perfect. You're never going to get perfect counsel in this word except on your knees from the Word of God. But the fact of the matter is, there's a place where even God himself says, that's it. And he turns people over to their own desires. If you want to walk with Christ, you're going to continue with all your heart to cry out to Christ. I don't care what you're wrestling with. If life is in you, there is something that will persevere. You don't know that that thing that rubs you so raw isn't exactly God's work of sanctification telling you what you are. My brethren, we have the better covenant. We have the better light than the saints of the old covenant. We must remember this. God has spoken. I say that with joy. God, the living God, has not stayed hidden. He has spoken. Have you heard Him? He has spoken. He's recorded it in 66 infallible books. He has spoken. Are you saying, Lord, help me to hear those 66 books? I want to walk in those books. I want to understand how they fall out, how they work together, and how it matters to my life. We are to understand that God has spoken, and then we are to apply it and obey it. I'm going to tell you, there are people, and I've seen them, I've talked with them. The minute you say the word obey, one word comes to their mind. Legalism. It's like, no. Jesus died upon Calvary's cross to make you like Himself. We're to walk, as John says in his first epistle, like Jesus walked. How did Jesus walk? According to His Father's Word. How did He walk? According to His Father's Word. And you know what? He loved it. He delighted in it. It wasn't the chains of legalism. He loved to walk with His Father because walking in the truth is freedom. Walking in the lies of the flesh is slavery. And when I say obey, I can put all of the footnotes to it that I need to. Everybody says, "Yeah, oh, I don't know." It's like, well, okay, yes, it's by the grace of God. It's only by the grace of God, but it's by the grace of God. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. You've got to buy a lot of commentaries to get around what that plainly says. Yes, it's by the grace of God. Friends, it's to be motivated by love for God. Why do I do it? Why should I obey this word? Because you love God. Because you love God. You love God for loving you and speaking to you and sending His teachers to you and sending His Spirit to you and gathering you with His people. You're to be motivated by love for God, not the slave master's whip. Love for God. Where does that love come from? Bathing your heart and your soul in His love for you. Well, I'm not going to do this because the pastor said that I shouldn't. Well, I don't normally say things like this, but I might be wrong. And if I'm right, you don't do it just because I say it, or Pastor Clarence says it, or Dr. Lloyd-Jones, or Dr. Behe, or Dr. MacArthur, or anybody you want to name. You do it because God says it. Because God says it. And because you love Him back with your life. It is by grace, the grace of God. It is motivated by love of God. Motivated by the love of God according to the Word of God. Not our own fancies, not our fences, but according to the Word of God. By faith in the Son of God and by the power of the Spirit of God. That's the Christian life. Does anybody here believe that? I know some of you do. Some of you are lost where you sit. And I don't say that to condemn you. God's going to do that at the last day. You need to look to Christ and make sure that He's speaking. And then your heart's desire out of love to Him is to respond in obedience. You want your life at least to look a little bit like your Savior. I was looking at some pictures that someone sent me just again this last week. And I had to take a deep breath as after I looked at a couple of these pictures. It was from a trip that Brother Nate and I made a few years ago. And I looked at those pictures, and I was in some of them. And I couldn't believe how much I looked like my dad. I always think of my dad in terms of an old fellow. And I looked, and I kept looking. And when you see younger pictures of me, I don't really look like my dad. But all of a sudden, through all the processes that I've been through and all the things that God has done, I look at that picture and I go like, wow. In fact, someone even saw me last year and said, oh, you look like your dad. I don't want to live like him. But my point is this. After some time of not looking like my dad, certain things, whether it be DNA or the way we've lived or all of that, all kind of work together. And while it's not a spitting image, I don't look just like Lou Pollard. There's a resemblance that's clear. Just before my dad died, I was at the nursing home, and I was shaving him, and I was getting him all cleaned up, and one of the nurses walked in and looked at him and looked at me and looked at him, looked at me and said, is that your brother? That's my dad. Oh, so sorry. Yeah. But the fact is, there was something identifiable. Brethren, is there something identifiable in you that looks like your father? Do you, stumbling, younger, growing, but is there something along the path that is beginning to shape up a little bit where you see family resemblance? This was missing from the scribes and Pharisees. They had lots of laws. They had added tons of things in their mind to honor the Lord, but they had glutted God's people with so many rules and regulations that the people really didn't even know and understand how to walk in the law of God. False doctrine or obscuring of God's truth keeps God's children from looking like Him. Don't just give me you believe in the doctrine of election. Do you believe that God said, be ye holy, for I am holy? How do we look like our Father in heaven? We try to walk by faith in His Son, in His Word, and people will begin to see the family likeness. Don't use grace as an excuse to wiggle out of that. Grace should be the very reason that you do it. It's the very energy, it's the very love of God manifest by the power of His Spirit in His regenerate people to learn how to walk with Him. Oh, I'm struggling. Well, that might be a sign of life. Praise the Lord. It doesn't say be perfect, but eventually we will be perfect as our Father in heaven is perfect. We'll be like Him. We will at least be sinless. We can debate how far the word perfect should be pushed, but we will be sinless and in His presence. Now then, we want to consider the people about whom Jesus is talking. Don't lose this picture. Jesus has been aiming his words at the scribes and Pharisees, but now he's talking to everybody in their presence about them. Don't live like them. How sober is that? That's astonishing. That's truly astonishing. See, we have already heard Jesus' parable about the man with two sons, which Jesus aimed at the chief priest and the elders. When told to go work in the vineyard, the second son said, "I go, sir," and went not. Jesus then told them, "Verily I say unto you that the publicans," that's the tax collectors, they were considered to be the scum of the scum of the earth. "The tax collectors and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you." Christ didn't just take them aside and say, "You know, it's all of grace. You guys got a few things wrong here, but don't worry about it. Grace, grace, everything's fine." He never said, "Peace, peace," when there is no peace. Oh, he could take his Peter aside and rebuke him because he loved him and he walked on with him. He could take Peter and say, "Satan has desired to have you, but I've prayed for you. And when you come through, you strengthen your brethren." That's our Christ. Notice he didn't say, "I'll even keep you from falling and denying me." He said, "But I've prayed for you, and I'll bring you through this. And on the other side, you're going to be a more humble man." Sometimes the Lord's got a furnace waiting for you, and part of it is to melt off as much of that pride that you don't think you have. Others have it, of course, but not you. No, you've got it. And sometimes the Lord custom engineers the bottom to fall out from under your life so that you wake up and say, "Where am I? What am I? Lord, you have my attention." That's a great place to be. It's exceptionally painful, but it's a great place to be. Sometimes that's far better than laughing with our friends. Brethren, here is hypocrisy in the flesh, standing before Jesus, standing before the people of whom they desire praise. And Jesus is pointing them out and says, "Don't live like them." And he's saying that to you and me. Don't say, but not do. It is the fact, and I wish I could say I'm exempt from this, but the seed of hypocrisy lies in the flesh of every true disciple of Jesus Christ. And the Lord, because he loves you, is going to make you aware of it. If he doesn't, something isn't right. Our flesh withers when we hear some of his commands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. You're going to spend the rest of your married life figuring out how to walk in that. But you need to be spending the rest of your life figuring out how to walk in that. Love one another as I have loved you. We're going to spend the rest of our lives working that one out. There are some people that are not that lovable. And yet Jesus loves us. And he says, "You know what? You know one of those things in the family that makes you kind of look like me is you love those that are not lovable. Brethren, don't say and not do. Don't say and not do. And when you say and do not, and the Lord shows you, repent. Look to the blood of Christ. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Well, when we see our hypocrisy, when we see the Pharisaic works coming out of us, and you really only see them if you spend time in this book, then by grace, by the cross of Christ, by that precious blood that was shed to cleanse us, we repent and we mortify it and we walk on. For we are, by the power of God's grace and faith in Him, to keep watch over His word and walk in it to His great glory and to our great good. If you hate obedience, something's desperately wrong with your understanding between good and evil. You hear that? Listen. Here's what the Apostle John said. For this is the love of God. Okay, what does the love of God look like? What does it mean for us to love God? Is it mountains and waves and oceans of good feeling toward God? Is that what he says here? No, he says, this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. Now, if you're constantly griping about what God's word says to you, something's wrong. Well, I don't want to let that go. That's why God's telling you. Well, that kind of makes me uncomfortable, because that means I'm going to have to change my life. Yes. Next. That's exactly right. Don't you understand that you and I are God's glorious projects? He's taken us out of our dung heap. He's cleansed us by the blood of Christ. And His goal is to make us like Jesus. Not sit in a church pew and go, oh, grace, love that grace. Let's see, it's time to do some channel surfing here and some binge watching. Really? Really? The end result is that we're going to look like and sound like and be like. We won't be, but we're going to be like Jesus. That starts here. Easy believism and American religion, which falsely hides itself and calls it Christianity, doesn't change people. It just makes them feel comfortable on the way to hell. But the truth of God transforms and changes people, and their lives go the other direction. That's what grace does. Do you believe that? Is grace that which stirs your heart to love God and walk with Him? Or is it your excuse and your license for disobedience? You've got to ask yourself some serious questions, just like I do. Jesus goes after the leaders of the people because they're leading them away from God's truth in the name of teaching them God's truth. They've so bound up God's law that people can't breathe in it. This is why Jesus says that they bind heavy burdens on people. well, you know, Pastor, I don't agree with you and Pastor Clarence about this and about that and about this particular thing and about this aspect of the Christian life. Well, we're not perfect people. That's true. And we don't know everything that the Scriptures say. That's completely true. And we would like to know it better, and we would like to live more holy before you. But why do you think we tell you? Why do you think we say, you know, we really encourage you, have nothing to do with this? Why? Well, it's either we're Pharisees trying to bind something on you that can't be found in the Scripture, or we understand something that God has taught us about how to be free. And we're miserable when we see you following after those things that ultimately are bondage, that ultimately are not going to honor your God, that things later on you'll say, it seemed like a good idea to me, but I'm really sorry I've spent 20, 30, 40, 50 years doing this. We want you to know freedom. That's precisely what the works of the Pharisees were not producing. Well, Jesus warned, don't imitate the Pharisees. They don't live what they preach. May all of us take that to heart. Now, Jesus then described the pride and the hypocrisy of the religious elite. Verses 4 through 7. I'm probably not going to make it all the way through that today with our time left. But we'll pick up where we leave off. Having declared their authority, Jesus then boldly and shockingly declared to the crowds in the presence of the leaders, for they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. Now, these heavy burdens were not the law of God, and I believe that a lot of modern Christians make a mistake when they think in those terms. These heavy burdens were not the law of God. They were the oral and written traditions of the elders that obscured God's law. These were not the inspired words of God, but they often became confused with it. And we can do that too, especially if you've been on the American journey. I mean, I've met people that say, well, I was a Roman Catholic and a Lutheran and a Presbyterian and a Baptist and a Pentecostal. You see people all the time in this state of flux just trying to get their feet on the ground somewhere. What's true? Where's a holy life? And in this country, it's exceptionally difficult to find it. I love my country, but it is apostate. Now you see, the multitude has listened. They'd been listening to the scribes, the chief priests, the elders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Herodians dispute with Christ. They'd been standing there all along hearing what's going back and forth between the leaders and this carpenter. Now Jesus turns to the multitude and he exposes the leaders' hypocritical hearts to all that are gathered. And we must grasp the significance of this. Jewish leaders and their heavy burdens stood in direct opposition to Christ and his calling men to the kingdom. There's liberty in the kingdom. Repent of your sins. Believe the gospel. Take up your cross daily. Deny yourself daily and follow after me. Who wants to sign up for that? Nobody. Unless the Spirit of God opens your heart. And then you find what freedom it is. Not to live like the world lives. Not to live choking on the traditions of men. What? What did Jesus say? He has said about them, he's described them this way. They bind up people with heavy burdens. At least some have attempted to try to understand exactly what the image here that Christ is giving. Some would say, well, they're taking these big old heavy things and they're putting them on people's backs. That's certainly possible. Others say, well, they're putting these burdens on, but they won't lift a single finger to help them figure out how to carry all that. Well, I'm not sure. It might be both of them. But here's the fact. Their traditions were described by Jesus as heavy burdens and grievous to be borne. Grievous to be borne. Grievous to be borne. Now, that should sound a little familiar to us, or maybe it would get us to think. But I want us to recognize that what Jesus is accusing these men of is the exact opposite of what he's calling men to. What did he say? What has he already preached broadly? Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now it's true, we can make that a very broad call. We can say, are you laboring under the weight of your sin? And do you want that burden lifted? Oh, that beautiful picture that Bunyan paints when he looks up, when Pilgrim looks up at the cross, and the burden falls off of his back. Yes, 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 that's all true, and that's a wonderful application. Wouldn't want to take it away from a single evangelistic method. But who's he talking to? Jews that are under the burden of man-made laws. There's at least one really narrow application here. Those that are laboring under all of the stuff that the Pharisees have bound them with and that are grievous to be borne, he's saying there's freedom. Come to me. Come to me. I tell you, modern American religion can do exactly that. It can bind you up with things that after a while you can't bear them if you're regenerate. If you're not regenerate, you're not going to love Christ's laws. You're never going to love his laws. They're just going to get in the way, but you'll find a way to make grace make you feel better. The fact of the matter is, if you have a new heart, you love his commands. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. Has anybody believed that? You've got to get down there and ask yourself these questions. Do you have the inoculation that American religion often gives people, false views of grace? It's astonishing to me when I'm down there talking to some of the homeless men downtown, and they're sitting there with their whiskey bottles next to them. They've lost everything, and they're telling me, they love Jesus, and it's all of grace. Like, man, you know, that's an interesting symbol of our nation. They don't understand the grace of God. It's become a license for them to live in their filth and be comfortable. God's grace will not let you be comfortable with the dung heap of this world. Please hear me. I'm not trying to make this difficult. I want a room full of free people who sing like they've been saved from their sins. Who have a life that say, man, I'm getting up today and I want to walk in what Jesus said to me yesterday. in the message. Jesus had said, come to me. And on his authority, I say, come to him. Come to him. Because you'll find this. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. That doesn't mean there aren't commands. That doesn't mean there aren't responsibilities. It means in Christ, you love him and you love what he gives you to do. Oh, I know the flesh is going to rebel. Mine does. You may not be as sinful as I am. But I have to fight when I read certain things in the scripture. How am I going to do that? How do I do that? And I try and fall on my face. And I try and fall on my face. But the Lord always gets me back up. And there's always the thing that gets me up is love for him. Love for him because he loves me. And I'm ready to get up and go. Is that the way you live? At least something like that. The Pharisees had their lists. And as long as they were kind of staying inside the lines of their lists, they thought they were okay with God. I know Christians that do exactly the same thing. Homeschoolers usually have pretty long lists. Listen, Jesus said, come to me. And now he's standing in the courtyards of the temple and pointing to the religious leaders and saying, but they tie heavy burdens on people. Look at religion without Christ, and then look at what Christ is saying. Come follow me. Hey, come be my slave, and you're going to find liberty. That sound backwards to you? That's what he's calling you to be, his love servant. Well, let me articulate just a few applications and we'll go. I intended to be completely finished by that thing today. Let me just say these to you. We'll pick up where we were next week, God willing, and we will develop these thoughts. But we still have a number of verses to go, and we're not finished with these. Now, in all of this that we've considered here today, Jesus was not only exposing the scribes and Pharisees' hearts, he was still training his disciples. He hasn't stopped doing that. He is teaching them. Why? Because they're going to be the foundation of the church he's building. He doesn't want them to be like the scribes and Pharisees, which is all they've known all their lives. He's teaching them to be the kind of leaders that he is and teaching them to be. And they're slow, just like we are. But there's growth. There is life. We can walk with Jesus because his burden is not heavy. When you fail, you look to the blood of Christ. And get up because he loves you. And go again. He says he was teaching them, It is clear by inference that he's teaching them what the leaders of God's people must and must not be. He is the example of what they should be. They are not. Boy, every elder, every preacher on the planet ought to sit up and take notice of this. Well, let me leave you with these thoughts. One, let us realize in this text that works righteousness is a dead religion. You're never going to be right with God, with all of your fences and all of that. You are not right with God by what you do. Though, if you are right with God, you will do because you love him. It's the rebound. Two, let us realize that in this text, we must be doers of the word, not hearers only. Okay, sermon audiophiles. It's fine to listen to all those hundreds of sermons that you've downloaded into your MP3 player. Is it changing your life? Are you hearing the word of God or simply a style that you like? Doers of the word, not hearers only. Some of us are not even good hearers. Three, let us realize from the text that mouth religion not only does not save, but it brings the wrath of God upon it. Mouth religion does not save. It incurs God's wrath. Why? Because you're taking God's name in vain. Oh yes, I'm a Christian. And then when we live like the world, we're taking that holy name in vain. Mouth religion does not, never has it, never will save. Four, let us realize from the text that the desire for the praise of men is hypocritical for Christ's people, evidence of an idolatrous heart, and ultimately damning to the soul. And look, we all want somebody to tell us we're okay. We all want somebody to tell us, I think you're wonderful. I think you're cool. I hear Christians all the time going, they just don't appreciate me at work. Well, they might not have any reason to. But even if they don't, I mean, even if they do, God put you there. And He didn't put you there to stroke you and make you feel wonderful. He put you there to sanctify you. Now, it's wonderful when people love you and affirm you. But if nobody did, where would you get your affirmation? Through the blood of Jesus Christ. We read Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6, where we are accepted in the Beloved. You get a hold of that, that's all you need. And it won't matter what other people think of you. I'm not saying to be obnoxious. I'm not saying that to be, you know, like, hey, you know, I'm really cool. I don't need anybody. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying you don't have to have the approval of the world when you are accepted by God in Christ. Fifthly, let us realize from the text that Jesus is always training us to be like Him. Always. He's always training us to be like Him. That's why you have some joys and some sorrows, some extraordinary triumphs and some awful defeats. But He's going to use all of those to make you more like Him. Well, we must stop. The theme is obviously hypocrisy and dead religion. And we will continue with those themes. And in the next message, we will pick up where we leave off here, and we will consider Jesus as, God willing, we may not get to it, but we will try to get to Jesus' correction in verses 8 through 12. So let us then look to Christ in faith, in humility, in grace. Let us know that His wonderful gospel says that those who repent of their sins and believe on Him have everlasting life and will not perish. And it's all because He loved us before the foundation of the world. Let that be the fire in your engine to serve Him. Amen. O Father, preserve us from hypocrisy. Oh, we say and do not. Oh, God. I know that I have. I pray that Thou wouldst help us to repent and to look to Thee in love, to know Thy great and glorious love in Christ, and that Thou dost nurture Thy people along the way. We know sometimes Your lessons are severe for us, Lord, but we praise Thee. When we come through on the other side, we can strengthen our brethren. Help us to walk with Thee with all of our hearts and bring glory to Thee. Help us to eschew hypocrisy. And help give us discernment to see dead religion for what it is. And may we walk in the life of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's stand. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do His will. Working in you that which is well-pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's go in the name of the Lord Jesus.